of yoga stop is yoga of enlightenment of consciousness. Vadalar goes further. He says, there is, the second step should be yoga of immortality. Now it is not there. And the third step is called yoga of divinity. So yoga of enlightenment is given in Mukti, that is by all the systems of spirituality. And yoga of immortality was given by the Siddhas and the alchemists of the world. But the yoga of divinity was given only by the Vedas. Aham Brahmasmi, I am Atma Brahman, Tattvamasi, Prajnanam, Brahma. Four Mahavakyas. They mean only one thing, that is, man is potential God. But how to translate it into reality? That was the question. And that was not properly answered by either Patanjali or by other rishis. I'm not putting the blame on the great souls. What I mean to say is that being a scientist in temperament, behavior, and his activity in life, he translated this Mahavakya, Aham Brahmasmi, into truth. And he has given us the nature of divinity itself and the yoga and science of how to make it into a reality. So that is the yoga of divinity. It has got three sections. First, this impure body has to be transformed into a pure body. It is called Sutta Deham. And then this pure body will start producing nectar. And what is the aim of Alala's yoga? See, this body should become self-sufficient. What I mean by that is that we are dependent upon nature for three things. Unless these three things are given to us, we'll die. One is food, another is breath or prana, the third is knowledge. Without these three things coming from the external nature, all of us will die, even the gods are no exemption. And Vallalar's aim of yoga is to make this human body into a divine body. What is a divine body? It is self-sufficient. Like the sun, all the other planets are dark in nature, but the sun is self-sufficient, self-radiating. It is producing light. In the same way, this body is capable of producing its own food, its own prana, vega kal, its own knowledge, arulayu or valari. So that is the final end of the yoga of Vallala. And it is given in three stages. First, mukti. Muktiyai petren, amuktiyinal, jnana sittiyai utren endru undi para, sittanum aniyan endru undi para. So first you should become a mukta, and then you should become a siddha, and then finally you should attain the state of Brahman or divinity. So this is the end of the course of what do you say? History, human history, natural history, all the history. God descended into this creation. It was called involution. Now we are going backwards towards the same, we are climbing the same ladder. So it is called evolution. What is the end of evolution? Man should become divine. To lead a divine life in a divine body is the end of my yoga of integrality, says Sri Aurobindo. That was said by Swami Vallala some 100 years before Sri Aurobindo and the mother. Unfortunately, their yogas did not produce any bodily transformation in them because they were only experimenting. But Swami Vallala succeeded in his experiments because he had before him the Siddha tradition starting from Valluvar, who says, even death can be conquered. Kutram kudithalum kaigur. So that is history. Today we are going to concentrate only upon the practicals. Now, yoga of enlightenment. Yesterday I told you what is Turiya. Now we are in the wakeful state. At night we are going to enter into a state of sleep. And during sleep we are going to enter into a state of dream. So this consciousness is like a frog. the Maharishi, exact Maharishi perhaps was more right than Darwin. Darwin says we descended from apes, but Maharishi says, Maharishi of Mandukya Upanishad says, we are all frogs. Like frogs, we are jumping from one state of consciousness into another. We are three persons. One person during wakeful state comes up, wakes up and acts. During sleep, another person wakes up and he is asleep, that's all. And we don't know what he is doing. There is yet another person acting through the dream state. So we are three persons, we are three fragments. First, all these three fragments of our consciousness should be united into one person, that is Surya. So if you are watchful, if you are aware of what is going on in your dream state, you can master the dream state. And then I wanted you to keep a dream notebook for that. And there are exercises for that. Yoga of sleep is there. You can a whole lecture on that part. Again, yoga of wakefulness. During the wakeful state, if you are watching not only what is happening in the external world, but also inside your mind and body. How is your body reacting to something? How is your body reacting to something? See, some of you are sitting in the dark, some of you are sitting in the light. But what? Because their body needs more sunlight to counteract this cold. So you must be constantly watching the reactions of your body and your mind. So it should be a two-way traffic. A new habit we have to form, and that habit should be there permanently established in the body. And finally, you should be aware of your sleep. I gave you an indication the other day that you should be able to hear your own snoring. Then you are aware of your sleep. So when this fourth state of consciousness called a witnessing consciousness, as Lord Krishna says in the Gita, this witnessing consciousness is established all through the time, all the 24 hours, all through the year, all the 365 days. Now, even at the time of death, if you are aware of what is happening at the time of death, you will become a Jivan Mukta, you will not die. Because your soul is in the form of knowledge. As long as that knowledge is retained in you, Lord of death cannot take away your soul. That was what happened to all the Jivan Muktas. They were able to retain their consciousness from the hands of the death, because they were always aware. They never lost their consciousness even for a single moment. Yesterday I told you about the Tailatara, that is like an oil pouring down which has no cessation of consciousness. You should have no cessation of consciousness. You must always retain your consciousness. That is the only purpose. That is the only way of attaining enlightenment. How to attain enlightenment? Never lose your consciousness. Even for a second. That is why Swami Vallalar says, no sleep, no samadhi, no death. Because all these three things are cessation of consciousness. Once you have cessation of consciousness, you have become a slave to nature. You are a slave to your instincts, but you should be a master of all of your instincts. And sleep is an instinct. What are all the instincts? They are our masters. See? We are controlled by these 22 strings of instinct, by the master nature, Panchabhutas. We have to be, on the contrary, masters of the Panchabhutas. We have to transform, according to the yoga of Vallalar, these five Panchabhutas into light of compassion. Well, that comes according to the yoga of divinity. Let us talk about it later. Now, one must attain the state of Turiya. If you are always in a state of Turiya, you are enlightened. Your consciousness will be retained, though your body goes and it is burnt or being buried. So attainment of Turiya, and there are, Vallalar says there are four levels of Turiya that comes under the yoga of divinity. What are the four levels of Turiya? Jiva Turiya, Para Turiya, Siva Turiya, Sutta Siva Turiya. The explanations we can have later. Now, the second thing is yoga of immortality, and they give you a formula. As Einstein summed up his relativity theory in the form of AE is equal to MC squared, the Siddhas give us a formula, and if you can successfully practice that formula in your life, Well, you can attain immortality of the body, that is consciousness of the enlightenment of the body also. It is called the kaya siddhi, immortality. It is possible according to the Vedas. We know about, we are taught about the seven Chiranjeevis in our epics like Anjaneya, Markandeya. We got about Aswatthama and seven Chiranjeevis are talked about. Though the exact science is not given there, Vallalar Swami has given us the complete science of one becoming immortal. So, Sagatalai Vogapunal Vogapunal Vegakal. It is not Vegatalai, it is Vegakal. Sorry. No. Sagatalai means undying head. What is undying? Now breath is going inside our head and it is dying. It should not die. Talai Sagatalai, Swami explains. And this breath that is going through our nostrils is called now Sagum Talai. It is dying breath. Whether it goes through the left nostril or through the right nostril, you are going to die. And this should be transformed into Pari. It is called, that it is given in the fable of Nariyai Pariyakkudal, Pariyai Nariyakkudal in the Thiruvasagam. Now, this breath is known as fox. What is it known for? For its cleverness. For its cleverness. So, as long as this breath goes, you will be, your intelligence will be very cunning, very clever. But it is not compassionate. You cannot go too far. Pari means horse. Your horse can run faster. And in the days of the Vedas and the Siddhas, what was the, I mean, which had the highest speed? I mean, this horse. Now it is the rocket. So, Pari means you can, with that breath, reach any place in cosmos in a moment. So, this breath must be replaced by another higher form of breath called undying breath. Vega call unburning, inexhaustible breath. When you have that sort of breath, you will not need this oxygen. This oxygen is dead by installment. It creates oxidation. Out of oxidation, you get oxidants. For that, you are prescribed by the doctor antioxidants. So it is killing us slowly. It is damaging our cell walls. It is damaging our body. Instead of oxygen, if you learn to breathe that eternal breath, it is called the holy breath and it is also called Paramahamsam. What is Paramahamsam? I already told you, Hamsam is a fabled bird that is able to separate the milk from the water. Now we are inhaling a mixture of oxygen plus prana. If you are able to inhale directly prana without the oxygen, you are a Paramahamsa. How to do it? That is the purpose and aim of Vasi Yoga. Then you can become a Paramahamsa. You can directly live on Prana Shakti, that is God's power of creation. You need not bother about this external air or breathing or oxygen. You become a Siddha. Our astronauts carry, what do they carry with them? Oxygen cylinders. The Siddhas don't carry any oxygen cylinders, but they are able to travel throughout the cosmos with this prana shakti. If you are able to directly take your prana shakti, you can travel anywhere. Your very body will become like a rocket. That is how these Siddhas roam around the universe. That's all possible when you have mastered this technique of Paramahamsam. That is the end of Vasi Yoga. That's why Swami says God himself is described as Vegada Kalanai, and Swami had attained it. Now, Poga Punal, what is meant by Poga Punal? A liquid, by its very nature, it flows from the highest place to the lowest place because of gravitation. But this Poga Punal, you know, it will resist the power of gravitation. It is anti-gravitational matter. Once you take it into your body, it will stay in your body and it will always be giving you, it will quench your water. This is talked about in the Gospel. Jesus Christ goes to a Samaritan woman who is taking water from the well, and he tells her, Oh woman, if you can give me this well water, I will give you water of life. Water of life? What do you mean, sir? It will stay in your body and it will, like a spring, will eternally give you water and you won't have any thirst at all. And what is that? Water of life. It is not described. And Swami gives us the details. That's why I say, if you can read Vadala's Tiruvarupa, well, you will be provided with the key to open all the scriptures of the world. That is the Poga Punal. Poga Punal means it is not removed from your body. It stays always in your body. That kind of Amrita nectar is produced from the external nature by the Siddhas, but Vadalar says it can be produced in one's own body. And finally, Sagatalai Poha Punal Vehaka. This is the yoga of immortality. And finally, yoga of divinity. And there are three stages. Now our body is in the impure condition. It is creating only waste material, and that waste material is sent out of the body, excreted through the 9 orifices of the body. So we have unfortunately transformed our body into a factory where only waste material is created, excretory matter is created. But by God's design, this body was created to be to create only Amrita nectar. How to transform this impure condition into a pure body where only nectar will be produced? When nectar is produced, what happens? You don't need a heart to pump your blood all through the body. You don't need oxygen from the external atmosphere to charge your cells. Both these things will be taken care of by the nectar produced in the body. Madalelam moolai malarndida amudam udalelam ootredu thodi nirambida, he will say. Then all the 8 systems of the body will be transformed into their higher stages. That is the pure body. Once you attain the pure body, it is supposed to be alive. Its lifespan is about 432,000 years. That is the impure body. Then you become a Siddha. And this impure body is transformed into a space body or Omkara body. That is how you become Shambhu Murti. That is, you have been blessed by your parents with that name. Who is Shanmuga Murti? If you can understand the meaning of that word, well, some of the greatest secrets of the Vedic rishis are revealed by that name. When Adi Shankara wanted to write a commentary on the Brahma Sutras, he went to get his blessings from his guru. And his guru said, do you want to write commentaries on the Brahma Sutras? You can do one thing. Go and read this Kanda Purana. There the secret is revealed. Suya Brahmam. See, what is the name of Subramanya Muruga? Su Brahmam. Su means Swayam. Self-made Brahman. How is a man to transform himself into Brahman? That secret is revealed in the story of the birth of Lord Muruga. So you read that person, Suta Samhita it is called. And it is, according to legend, Adi Shankara read it 18 times. How many times? 18 times to know that secret. After that only he wrote his commentaries on the Brahma Sutras, because Brahma Sutras reveal the very nature of Brahman himself, God himself. After that he wrote his commentaries. And that secret was kept there hidden for some 1300 years. After that, Vadalar came and he revealed that secret in the form of his flag. It is called Flag of Sanmarga. There is a lecture there. It is called a Flag Meditation. We won't have Flag Meditation taught today, perhaps in the next session. We have got 4 levels of yoga taught by Vadalar. Today we are going to see the first levels, some 10 meditations are there. We will see what time allows us. See, the next thing is, from space body, this Omkara body will be like a rocket. It can travel at the speed of light or perhaps more. Not at the speed of light, it can travel faster, because according to Vadalar Swami, there are 3 types of light. One is physical light that goes at the speed of 300 kilometers per second. And there is satellite called love. It is faster by millions of times. And there is the final light of compassion, which is the fastest light. In a second, it can travel to any galaxy. So, and Shanmugamurthy, how is it formed? Let me hint at it. I don't have the full time to explain it. That itself will take an hour. See, now you are taught beautifully by Dr. Shanmugamurthy how to transform your sexual fluid into your health and longevity. That is true. And Swami Vallalar says, this Bindu, spiritual energy is called Bindu. It has got two meanings. One is the liquid form of semen and sronida. This should be transformed into light by pure heat. That is what we are doing by the yoga of Kayakalpa, prayer, meditation, penance, tapas, like that. By that pure heat, this liquid is transformed into, first into an air. And then it is transformed finally into light. And that light is stored at the center of your forehead. And finally, what happens, you know, it coagulates itself into a solid body of crystal that has got six facets. A crystal of six facets. That is Shanmugam. Shanmugam means six faces. Then what happens? Your body is transformed from a pure body into an Omkara body, and you become literally like Lord Subramanya. Like Subramanya, who was to defend the gods against all the forces of darkness, you become the captain of light. You become the master of light. So this is the Omkara body. And finally, this light body of compassion is all pervasive. God's body is everywhere. It is hundreds and hundreds of times much bigger than this cosmos. Behind these physical atoms, you have got this light of compassion, all pervasive. It is the power that activates the inner subatomic particles like electron, proton and other things. So your body becomes everywhere. It becomes all pervasive. So this is the ultimate yoga, and there is no further yoga beyond the yoga of Vallalar. That is why I say, where other yogas end, Vallalar's yoga begins. Now, we are going to see some of the meditations of the first form of yoga of enlightenment. Now, first, three things we are going to cover. Every act of every day should be transformed into an act of yoga. That is what Vallalar says. What does yoga mean? Yoga means perfection, efficiency in your action. Any act, if you do cooking, it should be perfect. It should give you perfect taste. If you sit properly, you must sit. It should give you energy. You should not lose it. You see the photograph of Swami Vallalar. Vikram? See how Vallalar Swami sits. See, this is the correct posture of sitting. This is the yoga of sitting. See, he's sitting in Padmasana, Atta Padmasana or Padmasana. That is the way we have to sit. Then what happens? All of your energy is circulating inside the body. You don't lose it. And then he's clasping his left palm with the right palm. When you sit like this, this is the perfect posture. This is the yoga of sitting. By sitting like this, you will never lose your energy. Your back should be straight, and your legs and your hands, they should be united. By this, you are uniting both the parts of the body. Left body is the feminine body. The right side of the body is called male body, Ardhanarishvara. Every one of us, either male or female, is Ardhanarishvara. By uniting these two forces, one becomes more powerful than gods and goddesses. That is why all the Siddhas say this left side, our left feet, left hands, left eye, all these things are called you, Ugaram. And the right eye, right hand, right foot, all these things are called Agaram. 8. So when these 8 plus 2 are combined together, what happens? You give you beget a child. When A plus U, they are united, what happens? M is formed. That is how ohm is given. How do we get ohm? The right side is A, the left side is U. When these two are united at the center of the forehead, what do you get? Ohm. Dr. Shanmugamurthy was correctly pronouncing it. First, we start with when you close your lips, what happens? M is automatically formed inside. M means silence. So you get Om. And Omkara translation, Omkara Yoga has got five states. What is that? First, you start with the agaram, right hand, breathing through the right nostril, and then ugaram, breathing through the left nostril. When these two are united at the throat, it is called the Vasa Yoga. Then what happens? Immediately you get silence, M. Oh, if you still persist, what happens? The fourth state is called Bindu. Bindu means you will have light, real light, subtle light, divine light. If you still persist, you will have Paranada. You will hear the sound of the anklet of Lord Shiva. That is Om. That is A plus U plus M plus Bindu plus Nada. So Omkara has got five parts, five syllables. This is how we practice Omkara. Well, let us go to the next session. You see, daily regimen, Nitya Ulukam, four disciplines. Swami has given us discipline of the senses, discipline of mind, discipline of psyche, discipline of spirit. Now, discipline of the senses. Now we saw the meditation of sitting. Now, the meditation of walking. How do we walk? Normally, we walk in parallel lines. See, we walk like this. Like the railway road, we walk on the parallel lines. Now, instead of walking on parallel lines, according to this yoga, when you walk on a straight line, see, this is a straight line. You walk on a straight line. You could have seen these people doing in Hindu temples. When you walk on the straight line, what happens? Both the breaths, Idakala and Pingala, they are united, and your breath through the central column called Sushumnai, it will be awakened. The purpose of all activities is to awaken your Kundalini yoga and send it upwards through the spinal column. So, the walking, very act of walking, can be transformed into an act of yoga. That is what Swami does. Every act of your life is done mistakenly, and we have to correct it. And Swami has given us exactly what to do. For instance, the meditation of eating. How to do it? We don't know how to eat at all. We don't know what is the right food for us to eat. We eat meat and other sorts of poison, and we are poisoning our body every moment. And Swami says, you have to eat only the choicest food. How is atomic energy got? By using only a particular type of 235, what is it called? Uranium. Uranium. So, that is already emitting energy. In the same way, certain foods have got highest form of emitting energy. So, you will immediately get that energy. Calcined metals, calcined minerals, and undecaying foods. Well, that's a separate subject. So, choice of food is given to you. The second thing is, Swami says, you should drink your food. Nee arundhuga, unavai arundhuga. What does he mean by that? You have to grind it at least 100. You take a mouthful and grind it 108 times. There is a proverb in Siddha literature. It says, instead of taking 108 mouthfuls and munching it once, you take one mouthful and munch it, chew it, grind it, masculate it 108 times, you will get more energy. So, we are, in the name of fast food and eating fast, we are not getting enough energy out of the food. You are dumping our body with 2 kilograms, 3 kilograms of food, but to what result? We are not extracting enough energy out of that. How to get extract energy out of that? By munching it and mixing it with your saliva and then making it into a juice and drinking it. Not with the juicer or mixture. God has provided with the best mixture grinder in our mouth. With our saliva, you have to mix it and then take it. You are given 1 hour for lunch time. How much of lunch time you are making use of for your lunch? 2 minutes? Or 1 minute? Fast food. Swallow everything. Please never, never, never swallow. You are hurting your body like anything. If your cells in the digestive system, if they have got tongues, you know, they will cry like anything. You are making them work 100 times difficult. More difficult. So please chew and masticate your food. Take your own time. Make use of the lunch time. Only for lunch. Don't talk. Don't converse. Nothing. Nothing whatsoever you should do. And Scripture says, "Potri unga." Worship. In the days of the Vedas, people used to call Annam Brahmam. What is that? Annam Brahmam. Why did they say that? This Annam goes to create your semen, and that semen and Sronita, they go to make a man, and that man, by practicing meditation, becomes attains Brahman. So Annam becomes Brahman. What is Brahmacharya? The word, Sanskrit word Brahmacharya means, Ascharyam means to preserve. Brahmam. When you are preserving your semen, which is potential Brahman, you are preserving Brahman, you are creating Brahman. You are Brahma. Ascharyam means you have to preserve, safeguard, save. When you save your semen, you are saving whom? Brahman in potential. That semen is transformed into a human being. That human being could be transformed into a rishi who could attain Turiya, who could attain Paraturiya, Sivaturiya, and even attain Brahman state. So, Brahmacharya is the ultimate yoga. And Vallalar Swami says, you must have sex only once in 16 days. This is meant for the householders, not for others. For sadhaks, he said, not even a single drop of semen or sronida should be wasted. That is the most precious thing in the world. If you are a sadhak, that is your purpose. And for your information, I'll tell you, there is a small medicine called selenium, potency 6 or 30. Along with your kayakalpa practice, if you can take 3 globules before you go to sleep, well, your sexual juices will be preserved. It is called selenium 6 or 30. 6 will work with some people, 30 will work with some other people. Make it a point. Those who want to practice Brahmacharya can keep this in their mind, in their minds. And the next thing is, when you eat, how much of food you should eat? What is the quantity? Teen alavar indu unga. Teen alavar indu unga, says Vallur. What does he mean by that? Well, what is your hunger? It is some sort of a fire in your stomach. When you eat, what happens? That fire is quenched. When it is quenched, stop it. Don't overeat it. Not even a single extra mouthful should be added to your food. So who determines how much food you should take? Not you. The fire in your stomach, listen to it. Listen to the wisdom of the body. Then you will not fall sick. You will be always healthy. That Jadaragni is called. According to the Vedas, this body produces 7 types of heat. I don't have time to enter into that. Well, this Jadaragni, you know, in your stomach, it should be kept up constantly. There should not be any lack of this Jadaragni. This fire should be kept up. And it should be fed only as much as it wants, not you want. You have already taken your breakfast and you meet a friend, he says, let's go and have a cup of coffee. No. You say, I had my breakfast. Well, only when my stomach says, feed me, I should drink. Not because of your friendship. I'm not going to spoil my body. I'm not going to make it fall sick. So that is the quantity of food. And then Swami says, food has got five laws of nutrition. First thing, it should give you maximum heat with minimum quantity. The second thing is, it should not give you constipation. The third thing is, it should be easily digestible. And the fourth thing is, it gives you every object in the world, every being in the world is a mixture of poison and nectar. And Swami has given us a list of foods that contain the highest nectar portion. See, it's a different object our nutrition scientists do not know. He says certain foods have got highest portion of nectar. So see how much of nectar is in a thing and how much of poison is there. Your duty is to remove the poison first of all from the food and then take only the nectar portion. Then the next portion is, the next level is to do this thing by your cooking in the external world. Don't give this job to your difficult job of separating the poison from the nectar to your digestive system. Do it outside. What is the purpose of cooking? Separating the poison from the nectar. That is the purpose of cooking. Even the wisest Socrates was wrong. He said the purpose of cooking is to make the food tasty. No, to make the food endurable. Your milk will last for 1 or 2 days. Even if you keep it in the refrigerator, it may last for a few weeks. But if you convert it into, curd and then turn it into butter and then you do it into clarified butter, ghee, what happens? It lasts for 1 or 2 years. So the durability and the lifespan of the food should be extended. That is the purpose of cooking. So when you cook, you remove the poison from the foodstuff and you eat only the nectar portion of it. Unfortunately, our nutrition scientists, they calculate only about the calorie, but how much of gastric juices are used for translating this food into calories? We lose more. Actually, we are not getting enough. So that exchange is not taken care of. That should be taken care of. So Swami has given everything in this. Before that, potri unga, how to eat, with what type of mentality. Our mind is elsewhere and we are dumping food into our stomach. That is not the way to eat. And Swami says, have two things. First, you take the food with your hand. He was brilliantly telling you about that, the importance of food. We live by food. And you consider that food as divine. And what do you say to yourself? Yan irupozhudhu unda unavu muzhuvadhum amudamayina. Vallar Swami says, when you eat that food, with what intention you are eating? Oh God, please transform this food entirely into energy. Mind the words. How much of energy is transformed? How much of food is transformed into energy? Very little. And Swami says, Yan irupozhudhu unda unavu muzhuvadhum amudamayina. The food was totally transformed into energy. That was how he was able to live with enormous energy, with very little food. But how much of energy we get out of our food? We eat a lot. We eat very, very much. But how much of energy we get? Very little. So with this intention, you have to eat. Pray to God. Pray to God inside you. Please transform this food into complete energy. All the food should be totally transformed into energy. If you persist in this affirmation, your digestive system, you are talking to your digestive system and your absorption system, and your food will be totally transformed into energy. Then you will not need so much of energy. There will not be any hunger problem or famine in the world. So talk to your digestive system. They are sensible. They are already functioning divinely, even without your own permission. If you are allowed to manage your digestive system, what will happen? You will not last even for a week. It is being taken care of by the God. So please talk to that God. Thank God. Consider food as divine. Don't waste it. Every day we are wasting a lot of food. Okay, that is meditation of eating And very important thing, excretion. Swami does not leave anything for chance. This is called a toilet meditation. Some of you might laugh. Even this thing, could this thing be translated into an act of yoga? Yes, Swami says, go to the toilet first thing in the morning. First thing in the morning, you must have that urge. Actually, that urge to excrete should get you out of your body. That is the indication that your body is properly functioning. How to do that? If you find that your urinating is not complete, that something is there in your bladder, and Swami gives us a technique. He says, by your left hand, you hold the right side of your stomach. Please do that. Otherwise, the habit will not be formed. Otherwise, once the habit is initiated, it will continue. Now, with your left hand, you touch the right side of your stomach and concentrate on urinating. And until the whole bladder is emptied of urine, you should not think of any other things. If you do not practice concentration in your job, in your office, it's all right. Well, but this is very dangerous. Your bladder should be completely emptied. In the same way, the second thing, passing stools. When you go to the toilet, make sure that all of your bowels are completely cured. This is very, very important. It is not a laughable matter, because constipation is the worst disease possible. It is the mother of all diseases. If there is constipation, if it persists, what will happen? It will give piles and fistula. If you still ignore it, what happens? It may turn into colon cancer. The doctors here will tell you more about it. So it's the worst thing of all. So there should be no constipation at all. Swami says there should not be constipation in two places, in the lower Mooladhara and in the upper Mooladhara with the phlegm. That's why he wants you to take this Parisalai. We are going to see that. Eclipta alba, first thing in the morning with your milk or with hot water. And then you have to rub the paste of the Eclipta alba upon the roof of your mouth. Then what will happen? Even the excessive phlegm will come out. You won't have any sinus problem, asthma problem, and other respiratory problems. So this is about food. And after that, every act should be done as an act of yoga. Well, I will now pass on to the, there are about 80 acts of yoga. 80 acts of everyday acts of yoga are transformed into actions of yoga by Swami. It is given in Nitya Udukam. It is called the daily regimen. Daily regimen, the CD is there. I don't have time to enter into all that. This whole lecture has been given on that. 80 things which we are doing in our everyday act, they have been perfected. You have to do according to that. Then you will not fall sick. You will not have diseases. The body will not be impaired. Now we are entering into the, Swami says, well, how to discipline your mind. எப்போதும் சிச்சவையின் கண்ணே கவனம் வைக்க, அதற்கு முதலில் புருவ மத்தியில் கவனம் வைக்க. There are two steps for controlling your mind. How to do that? The first thing is புருவ மத்தி. Third eye meditation. Well, yeah, it's all right. Walking meditation is over. I told you, no, to walk on the straight line. Now, about discipline of the mind. Now, please sit erect. I think we have already done it in some other place, but I find new faces. For enlightenment, we have to do it. Just for 1 minute. Now remove your glasses, please. With your right thumbnail, scratch in between your eyebrows for an inch, from the bottom up, just for an inch. And close your eyes and watch that pain. This is the place where you should always concentrate. If you concentrate on this point, 6 types of energies which you are losing at every moment, you will be saving, you will be conserving it. Your reproductive, please close your eyes and concentrate on that place. This is the most important place in the entire cosmos. This is where your body and mind are united. This is where your body and soul are united. This is where your soul and God, our soul is united. This is where your body is connected with the nature. This is where your mind and buddhi and soul are connected. So this is the place of utmost importance. That is why Swami says, all the 24 hours, your attention should never, never come down from this place. This will make you a siranjeevi. Siratileye jeevipavan, one who always lives in the head, like Anjaneya. He is supposed to be an immortal. If you want to become an immortal, or at least if you don't want your health to be impaired, please concentrate on this place. Please close your eyes and put your concentration on that place. Just to concentrate on that place for 5 minutes, you will feel refreshed. You will have a lot of energy, because all the six energies, every moment you are losing, will be saved. What are the six energies? Your reproductive juices, your gastric juices, your breath, and then your speech, and then your eyesight, and then your thought. All these six forms of energy you are constantly losing to gravitation. If you concentrate on this place, you will be preserving, conserving and saving all these six types of energy. If you can do it for a few years, you can have more energy than the Kundalini energy, according to Jiddu Krishnamurti, the Indian born philosopher. Very simple technique, but very helpful. It will give you all the health, it will give you all the brain power, it will save your sexual energy, it will give you brahmacharya. Thank you. Now, we are entering into the second phase. What is the second phase? Now, Swami says, there is a place where God dwells inside your body. That place is called Sitchavai. Eppodum Sitchavai in Kanni Gavanam Vaikka. Unfortunately, that place has been hinted at in all the scriptures of the world, but nobody has revealed so far exactly where is this place in our anatomy. Even Christ says, the kingdom of God is within you. Our Tirumular says, நெற்றிக்கு நேரே புருவத்து இடைவெளியில் உற்று உற்று பார்க்க ஒளியுடும் மந்திரம் பற்றுக்கு பற்றாய் பரமன் இருந்த இடம் சிற்றம்பலம் என்று தேர்ந்து கொண்டேனே. Exactly where is it? At the center. You see, that is the cross. What is the cross? What does it mean by it? You have the perpendicular line from the center. This is the center place of the crown. Crown opening it is called. Melvasal, in Tamil it is called. There is a small place here, you know, if you touch the newborn baby, you can find some small pit there. It is called crown pit. From that crown pit, you have a perpendicular line through your ovula and then through the eyes. You have a straight line, horizontal line. When these two lines meet in one place, and that center is called cross. At that point, you have your soul Atman. You can find it out. Swami Vallar tells us, he has given us a mantra. We don't have much time to explain all those things. I'll pronounce it. Please pronounce with me. Four steps are there. What is that? Pronounce along with me that mantra. Second thing is, hold your breath for a minute. Third thing is, you have to keep your tongue up in the air. It should not touch the upper palate, it should not touch the lower palate. And the last thing is, there will be some kind of pressure above the roof of your mouth, and you should watch exactly the location of that place, and you can drop your tongue, you can breathe out. So where is that pressure coming from? That pressure point is exactly the place where the Atman is situated. That is Sitrambalam, that is Sidambaram. So that is where God dwells, that is where your Atman is. Find out that place at the time of death. Whoever keeps his attention in that place will become a Jivan Mukta. As simple as that. And I hope all those who are assembled in this hall must have Mukti in this birth itself. You pray to your Guru, you pray to God for giving you the boon of the success of this yoga. Now I am going to pronounce that. Please stay with me. Sit straight. Up.
Up.
Hold your tongue, hold your breath. Watch where that sound came from, the origin of the sound, and there will be some sort of pressure upon the, above the roof of your mouth. You can feel it. Just locate that point. Locating is important. That is where your Atman, Uyir, is. This is the ultimate secret of secrets, kept hidden by the Siddhas all over the ages. Shall I repeat it once again? Ak.
Ak.
There will be some pressure above the roof of your mouth. Do you find it? Those who have found it, please raise their hands. Very good, very good. Oh, there are only 5 minutes left. Shall we pass on to other exercises? Or somebody has got some doubts as to the location of the place? Please, those who want to continue it, raise your hands. Okay, I'll tell it once more. Please watch 4 steps. First, pronounce with me. Second, hold your breath, hold your tongue, and see where the pressure is. 4 steps. Okay, now, up.
Up. Up.
Hold your tongue, hold your breath. Watch the pressure, where it comes from. Above the roof of your mouth, there will be a place. Do you find the pressure there? Very good. How many of you feel the pressure there? Oh. Oh, very good. Very good. Okay. Now rub your palms, put them in front of your eyes. Looking at the palms, please come out of your meditation. That is how one should enter into meditation and come out of it slowly, not in a hurried manner. That will impair the system of the body. Now, we are going to see the third eye meditation. This is very, very important. This will boost the energy of your brain. Unfortunately, now they say about 5%, not even 5%, 3% of our brain cells are functioning. Even with the great scientists like Einstein, from 5 to 50% of their brain cells are functioning. And the remaining 85%, they are lying dormant, they are lying asleep, they are totally useless. We have to activate the whole brain. Then what happens? According to the film, Hollywood film Lucy, everyone can become a Siddha. If 100% of the cells of the brain are activated, everyone should see that film, not for its entertainment, not for its crime and violence, but the theme is a brilliant theme. It's a theme of the future. It is called a Lucy, L-U-C-I-E, Lucy. Now, the third eye meditations. Now we have seen 2 things. What is that? Focusing on the third eye period, third eye location. And the second thing is exactly where is this Chittambala. Now, the third meditation is that we have to breathe through the third eye. You have seen the picture of Shiva. You have seen the vertical eye of Shiva. Though you are breathing through your nostrils, you are creatively imagining, visualizing that you are breathing through the third eye. You are inhaling through the third eye and you are exhaling through the third eye. Then what happens? This place will be activated. This Ajna Chakra will be activated. Shall we do that? Okay, so sit straight. Remove your glasses. Now make a scratch with your thumbnail. Now you start inhaling through the third eye. Forget about your nostril and its breath. It will naturally go on. But you are breathing through your third eye. Then what you are inhaling? Direct prana you are inhaling. Inhale deeply through the third eye. When you exhale, exhale through the third eye. Inhale through the third eye, exhale through the third eye. That is the organ of breathing. Do you feel that place activated? Do you feel some kind of a sensation as if an ant is crawling there? Yes, please come out of that. Arat Perunjodi. Now there is one more minute left. So we are going to enter into a very important meditation on the third eye. Now, please sit erect, close your eyes. Imagine that your brain is in the form of a white lotus bud. Imagine a white lotus bud in the region of your forehead. And in the midst, please imagine a flame. That is your Atman. Inside that flame is God Arup Perunjodi. So first imagine a white lotus bud, and at the center and above of that bud, imagine a flame. When this image is permanently established, please raise your hand. If you are able to see the white lotus bud, nothing but the lotus bud, please raise your hands. You have attained the first state of meditation. Imagine a white lotus bud. At the center and above it, there is a flame, a light, a lamp. That is your Atman. Now we are entering into the second state. You don't have time. Now imagine that bud is blossoming fully. That white lotus bud is blossoming fully with all the 1008 petals. Sahasrara. It is blossoming into a white lotus flower. All the 1008 petals are blossoming openly. They are opening. When a flower blossoms, what happens? You will have honey. It will produce honey. So a honey of red color. It is called Sivani. It is given by the Lord. It is heavenly nectar. You have a spring at the center of the flower, and this red color honey is flowing like a spring, a fountain. From there, it fills up your entire head. Your Atman, that flame, is anointed with that. Abhishekam takes place with that honey, and it fills up your head, it fills up your throat, it fills up your shoulders, it fills up both the arms, and it comes down to the middle, and it fills up your chest, it fills up your stomach, that honey fills up your abdomen, it fills up your both of your legs. So the entire body is filled up with that nectar. Just imagine. Now it is an imagination, it is an act of imagination, but with the practice, with the right way of eating and thinking and praying and meditation, this will become an act of reality. When it happens, Jiva becomes Shiva. Jiva is being transformed into Shiva. This was what was called Soma Bana by the ancient rishis. Swamiji has given us the technique of achieving it. It is called Arulamudam, the ultimate form of the result of yoga. there are a few more meditational techniques at the level one, but unfortunately we don't have time. When I come next time, I'll try to instruct you with other forms of yoga. Please come out of your meditation. Arpirum jodi, arpirum jodi, anipirum karunai, arpirum jodi, illa uyirhalum inbutru aalha, vallal malaradi vaalha vaalha. Thank God, thank Guru, please take the blessings of the Guru. Without the blessings of the Guru and God, these yogas, ultimate yogas, well, they cannot be realized.
It was indeed a wonderful practice. Got a lot of yogas in one short session. So I hope you can all practice it. So next we'll have, coming to the conclusion of our programs. So the next we will have a valedictory address. The topic of this one is Introduction to Spirituality by Dr. Abhinav Agarwal, PhD. Let me tell you a few words about him while we are setting things up. Dr. Abhinav Agarwal is the author of the book, September 11, A Wake-Up Call, Scientific Analysis of the Problem and Suggested Solutions. The book received IEEE Author of the Year Award. He is the founder of the Society for Universal Oneness. The website is www.sfuo.org. It's a non-profit organization focused on creating a better world through environmental and educational projects. His forthcoming book, One World, One Nation, An Interdependent Business Model, will focus on uniting a divided world. And he has another book that is coming out, which will be published by the end of the year, Face to Face with Shiva, Scientific Perspective of a Spiritual Experience. This book explains his real life experience of sighting Lord Shiva and how that experience and ongoing dialogue is important to saving our planet. An interdisciplinary scientist and researcher, he wants to create technology-based solution to solve problems related to environment, difference between nations, terrorism, and to eliminate ignorance, poverty, and hunger. Please welcome Dr. Agarwal.
Thank you very much for providing me opportunity at a very short notice to enter this I have 15 minutes or 10?
15 minutes. 10 to 15.
Okay.
It's on. Just keep the mic closer.
Okay, that's fine. So, I will try to summarize basically the theme of the current book, Face to Face with Shiva, Scientific Perspective of a Spiritual Experience. As she said, the other book you can download from the SFPO website. It's a free download. If you want hard copy, you can go to Amazon. So this particular book that is in the draft stage, it will be going for publishing hopefully towards the end of the year. And if you want a copy, you can request it. Free copy of the manuscript, we can email to you PDF format. So it is based on my real life experience. When I was a teenager, it's the first time today that I'm publicly sharing that experience. When I was a teenager, in year 1970, December in the state of Jammu and Kashmir in northern India. A very unique something happened, very, very unique experience I had. We were performing a yajna in the open air, and suddenly I saw on my right side there were like earthen blocks. So through the wall, a blue shining light appeared.
Can you hold the mic a little bit closer? We're not able to hear you.
Yes. So, I was sitting here and there is Kavan Kund in front of me, and suddenly my attention is drawn. It was around the dusk time, around 7 p.m. Then you know it's neither day nor night, but it's like the dusk time. So from my right side, I see a bluish light, and that draw my attention. So through the earthen blocks, a huge bluish light appeared, and it was the lad. And the very next moment, Lord Shiva is standing in front of me. More than 100 feet tall, bluish light emitting from his entire body, he was standing in front of me. And then he took a Padmasana posture, sitting right there, just between me and him, just like you are sitting here. That's the separation we had. In between was the Havan Kunda. But just, I told you, more than 100 feet size, just in front of me. And there was no lip movement, but we did talk. And what was the talk? So he asked me, do you want me to be with you forever, always? Do you want me to be with you? So the way I have been brought up since I was a child was that if somebody offers you an arm, don't try to hold more than a finger. And I responded, I said, I have seen you, that is enough for me. I don't even need anything else. And Lord Shiva is always known to be a man of few words. You know, if you read whatever the literature or anything, he's supposed to be a man of few words. So the very next moment, the Lord gets up, no steps on my right, like this, diagonally here. And he raises one leg. No, his back is towards me. Raises one leg, then raises the other leg. He's suspended in the space, in Padmasana, and then starts moving away from me. And if the bluish light going further and further away in the sky, and it's going towards, and then it turns a bit towards the left, and I can't see that light anymore. So I'm just dumbstruck. I can't believe it, as if, you know. So it took me some time to recover from that. So there were two gentlemen sitting next to me also in that yajna. So I asked them, did you see anything? And they said, no, we did not. And ever since then, you know, I just kept it to myself. I did not even share it with my mother. And the reason this book is being written is that somebody had a very violent argument with me. And after that argument, he convinced me to write this book. He said, and I have jumped from an airplane. I had a plane crash from a burning aircraft. I jumped. And I said to myself, maybe what he's saying is right, that there is probably this. To write this book is the only purpose of my remaining borrowed time while I'm on the planet. So I thought, there is something which needs to be done. I need to write this. And as hard as it is to write a book, I did it. I'm glad that it is there now. And if you will see some parts of that book, what Lord Shiva is revealing is basically some knowledge. He's revealing the knowledge about the secret of the creation of the world, the purpose of our life on the planet, and also what each one of us can do, what each one of us can do, basically. So this is, I with the limited time that I have, I'll just focus on two things. You know, this is one of them, abstract neural networks. How did Lord communicate with me? He did not speak, I did not speak. How did he communicate with me? So today, I use the computers. I'm a computer scientist for my day job. I use the computer, I type something in, right? And then I save it in a file, I transfer the file, or in a chat, I put it, and it's going through the network, you know, that whole process is there. Is it necessary? Is it efficient? No, it is not. Or I read the book to get something. Sometimes I'm able to communicate with like-minded people, probably at a thought level, okay? So that is the abstract neural network. So there's a whole chapter in the book on this. The other thing he reveals is that we know what is a super element, how that is decomposed to three basic constituent elements, and it's the combination of those three constituent elements that everything is produced. The purpose of our life is to return a useful value. So when do we, so moksha and nirvana are little different concepts, and also reveals, the Lord reveals that, you know, how do we attain that? Once we return useful values, you know, we have attained the purpose of our life. So it is not just that I could be perpetually in meditation. You know, the very thought that, you know, as esteemed speakers before me described, that, you know, I'm being selfish if I'm saying that I want to attain moksha or nirvana. That is really being selfish. And that is also some kind of a, you know, if I'm thinking that I'm superior than others, that's some kind of violence already there. You know, we talk about ahimsa. It's compassion is the highest religion, and you know, spirituality is actually above all religion, right? And all knowledge is spiritual. So the term spirituality was introduced in the 9/11 book, which is a free download, you can see. And there's a definition of this whole thing, you know. So all knowledge is spiritual. So when you see a Newton, he will see an apple falling. So he will see an apple fall. What is inspired to him that there is some force which is pulling the apple? Millions and millions of people would have seen this apple falling, but he was implanted, he was inspired with that knowledge. What are those sages you're doing, you know? Somebody may say, oh, all these rishis, you know, these guys, they are just wandering the Himalayas, they are useless people, they are not contributing anything to the world. What is it that they are doing? They are radiating positive energy. There is a balance that must always be maintained. This is the theory of the wave. So all over negative actions, negative karmas that we do, those are creating negativity in the wave. So we know if you look at the amplitude, it needs to be balanced, it needs to be wiped out. Why do tsunami happen? You know, or why do other tragedies happen? It is to maintain that balance, you know. If we collectively meditate, we raise positive energy, we do something positive, that's basically going to wipe out some of the negativity. So we need to keep on doing that, you know, like collective meditation is a wonderful thing to do. Abstract neural networks, I talked a little bit about it, that, you know, you can communicate at the thought level. So abstract neural network alone would basically bypass all of that stuff, you know, that you have, you know, you have to really type and then it goes through that. And, you know, I travel in flights and even in the red eye, I see everybody just working on the PPT. You know, it is really useless. I mean, if we can communicate at that level, and today we are only competing, there's an RFP response, 100 companies respond. How much time is being wasted? Just we are competing. And we have to shift that paradigm. When you talk about the paradigm shift, if we start cooperating, we'll be wasting so much less resources, and we'll be giving a lot more collectively as humanity. And imagine what is going on in God's mind. If you are a parent and you have two kids, or you have 100 kids and they are fighting and killing each other, how would you feel? That is what how God is feeling when we are doing war, we are fighting, you know, we are killing each other. That is how God is. I believe my time is already up.
Yeah.
2 minutes? Okay, thank you. You're very kind. This is almost the closest replica of how Lord appeared. So this is basically a statue in Mangal Mahadeva statue near IKI airport in Delhi. but they have made a similar one in near Kathmandu also. And that is actually, I am paying homage to at Kailash, on the Kailash Yatra, and that's the Mansarovar Valley Lake, you can see. So, you know, so Lord reveals a lot of things. You can have your own personal connection to Lord Shiva. There's nobody needed in between, honestly. I am also not a needed in between, or I'm just the messenger here to tell you that you can have your own very personal connection. And the very term Om Namah Shivaya, what it means, is the first thing in the book that you can see. It is Om Namah Shivaya means bowing in respect to divinity within and without. So what is the divinity within? Is the integration of your mind, body and spirit, wonderfully, which has been described in the previous session. And outside divinity is everywhere, everywhere in the universe. And you know, the oneness is that this whole of the mind, body, spirit be combined with that whole which is everywhere else, you know, that is the oneness. So thank you very much for listening and being so patient. And if you have any questions, maybe in that remaining minute or two, we can take a couple of questions.
I just have a comment, totally kind of not related, but somehow related. There is a term called remote viewing, and this is scientifically done by US military, and they've been using it, and now it is available in public domain. That also talks about communicating, start level. So,
yeah,
you
have 2000 for a project. To see, you know, this, you can do telepathy, but that, you know, to see things in the Russia, you know, you can see from far away. So they funded, you can do it online. So they wanted to fund for research.
One thing I want to tell you,
We'll have the comments and everything later on, because the community center people are all very strict. We have to vacate this hall at 6 o'clock. So maybe we can talk in the parking lot afterwards. So. Let's this one. 1 minute, Dr. Vinavagavan. We want to. One minute. Master. Please appreciate access a small token of our appreciation. Next, we have rapid presentation session. It's going to be just 10 minutes, 15 minutes maximum, not even 15 minutes.
No,
because,
8 minutes.
Yeah, so 10 minutes maximum. So I'll ask you to keep it to 8 minutes. Our first speaker is master in Sky Yoga, Kali Das. He's going to talk on sages and servant leadership.
I hope you are all enjoying the sessions and starting your spiritual journey. And today's topic is sages and servant leadership. I know if you are all working in different companies at different levels, how many of you think yourself as leaders? So only few, but the answer to this question is everyone is a leader. The topic is the servant leadership. To become a servant leader, you need to serve first, then you become a leader. So this concept, we are going to talk about what is servant leadership, some examples of world leaders and spiritual leaders. Then we are going to see some of the examples within our community. Then finally, what's your takeaway from it? So this was created in 1970. The word was coined in 1970 by Robert Greenlee. There are 10 characteristics to become a servant leader. Many companies today are following this and being successful. Some of the companies you can see is Starbucks, United, Southwest, are some of the companies that are following this thing. And they see tremendous improvement in the productivity gain and employee engagement. Some of the things what you see here is directly related to what we talk in today's sessions. Like Kuppuswamy here talked about compassion, and next one is awareness. We learned awareness, how to gain awareness. All these things, we don't have time to talk about everything, but some of the things we have to see here is empathy. Within your team, empathy is something like you start with sympathy. If someone is sick, you send a card. It's a sympathy. Then empathy is someone is feeling through him, feeling like him. So if someone is needs help, you think like him and help him as a team, above and beyond your level of managing or within your team. And I was talking to Kuppuswamy, yeah, he was saying about compassion. Compassion is above and beyond the empathy. Which, you know, who is looking for a help, you go and help him. So that's what all the things what you are talking about here is what we learned on these 2 day sessions. So some of the leaders who followed the servant leadership, you can see here by looking at the face, you know that Gandhi, he preached ahimsa and non-violent, he gave freedom. That he's one of the great example of servant leadership. And Martin Luther King was working here today, treated equally like other citizens, because of his cause and leadership. And third one is Nelson Mandela, who worked for anti-apartheid. So like I said, no one has given leadership title for him. No one has asked him to work on this cause. They have taken this cause and took it forward. One of the examples of sages we have seen, all these three leaders primarily preached compassion. Compassion is the attainment to God. So Vivekananda as well as the Vallala and Vedantri, we took those things and see how we can transform ourselves using these techniques, practices and principles. Now coming out, some of the examples within our community, let's see some of the examples among us. One of the examples we can clearly talk about is in the world of power, money and fame, many of us take the knowledge what like Kuppuswamy could have transformed his learnings into making money, millions of money. But he decided to work for, take these principles and teach us to bring it to our next level. So he is one of the true examples of a servant leader. Next one is Dr. Sean. You can always say he is visiting second, third time, right? So he can live in luxury, comfort, and in the home, sitting and just enjoying the weekends. So he is taking time to spend and create a cause and making, helping us to translate the ancient science into modern modern community. That is true example of a servant leader. The third one I would say Vikram. 6 years back when we started this, nothing. We just 10-15 people attended this. And now you can look at it. This is the second conference he is conducting with this whole 2 day session, conducting with one person with the help of a few others. I think that's one of the true examples of servant leadership. The next one is the connecting our roots. Here is the language. Language, Tamil is the language, Thiruvarupa, everything is written in Tamil. Few years back, I think 7-8 years back, few leaders started to think, let's bring that language, teach that language to next generation. And few of the leaders sitting here, Ajinkya Ravi, Raji and Sher and Dr. Sher. So those leaders, one of the leaders that started in a small way. Now we have 250 school students, next generation school students with 50 volunteers. They are running continuously and it's also approved by Wake County. So these are the true examples of servant leaders within our community. Now let's look at, we look at leaders, we look at spiritual leaders, we looked at our community and what you can do. That says, start with you. First, you have to transform yourself. You need to understand, you still learn many things. Now start your spiritual journey today by transforming yourself. You can see there are some paths, but there are many paths laid out by the sages. There you can choose whatever you are passionate about. You can pick and choose anything you want, but promote the ancient science and also create awareness. Once you do that, then do with others. Like once Martin Luther King said, you can go fast by going alone. But if you go together with everyone, you can go so far. You can go far. That's what we would like to reach. That's the message I would like to give. Thank you.
Wonderful speech. If you all didn't know, let me just say that he's got a PhD in management, and it really showed in those slides that he put together. I request Assistant Professor Sundar Kalyapiraman to give a token of appreciation. The next rapid presentation is going to be by Karthi. He's a chip design engineer working at Qualcomm. His topic is going to be on utilization of anger.
Yeah, good evening all. It gives me immense pleasure to present one of my favorite topics from the introspection lectures. Hope you guys are having two good days of spiritual and scientific enlightenment. Swamiji, the most of the slides are prepared from the writings from the Swamiji. So I am presenting it from an engineer's point of view, so that it's the information can be shared and assimilated in a easier fashion. So Swamiji believes that anger is the chief among the one of the chief and evil emotion which we need to overcome and eliminate from our day-to-day life. He believes that anger prevents us from our pursuit of leading a very calm and peaceful life. So how many of you have experienced anger in your life? Can you raise your hand? So how many of you feel that you can do more to eliminate this negative emotion from your life? Can you please raise your hand? So here Swamiji is trying to address this problem in a more scientific aspect, and he's trying to suggest a very good solution. That's what I'm trying to present here. So let's see what anger is. Okay, so assume there is a person A. Okay, he has some want or need for his own enjoyment, and is in this pursuit. And then assume there is this person B or a material. You can assume it to be some obstacle. So in order to satisfy his want or need, he needs to overcome that obstacle. So the moment what you do is you'll start applying force to overcome the obstacle. Say for example, if this obstacle, it could be a person or a material, is uneasy, that's when the person A is like getting frustrated. So at this point, he's trying to apply more force, and he reaches a point wherein the mood called anger sets in, because he's not able to get what he wants or what he would like to enjoy. So Swamiji came up with this model. This is the reason why any person gets angry. So he's trying to explain what happens in your physical, mental, and social level I mean, how anger affects a given individual. We all know, I mean, what happens when you or me gets angry. I mean, your eyes get congested, your blood pressure rises up, your heart beats faster, and your nerves become strained because you're no longer able to speak coherently. You are ready to, I mean, attack the other person. And when you look at it from the mental level, I mean, your self-awareness is lost. You're no longer in control of your own self. And your life energy becomes depleted. So Swamiji came up with a very nice example. You can imagine anger any person is subjected to, like eating an aluminium metal element. So what happens is this aluminium metal transforms into a liquid state and then into the gaseous state. So what happens at the atomic level is these atoms are subject to vibrations, and the vibrations are so rapid and going at a higher rate that there is a state transition happening. The same way, your body, which is made up of energy particles, the life force, is subjected to enormous pressure and vibration. I mean, you're ending up losing all those energy. So after, anytime, no, you are subjected to this emotion called anger, after you come back to the reality, you feel very tired. The main reason is how much energy you expend just because, I mean, you were undergoing this negative emotion. And the mind is getting affected with harmful emotional habits. You start thinking about all that hidden, you add about that other person, okay? You start yelling at that person, using all those things you're bottled up within you. And then psychologically, the method he's suggesting is try to identify the source and let's see how we can fix the problem. The first thing is list out the persons with whom you're prone to anger with. So you can order in terms of priority. It could be your spouse, it could be your kids. You can record the answer, why do I get angry with that person? Okay, what that person is doing which makes me getting angry with that person. And then the third question is a very important question. Is it the person's fault or am I doing something to trigger this situation? So it's an eye-opener. So you have to be very conscious, okay, when you think about this question. And the fourth question is, what actions you have taken to mitigate the situation? And the fifth question is, if you truly believe the fault is only with the other person, do you think that by expressing your anger can rectify the situation? The answer to this question is yes. Then the very fact that the person is in the list in the first question, says proves that, I mean, by showing or expressing anger, you cannot mitigate the problem. So this is an eye-opener. You can write on a piece of paper. And then one of the solutions we suggested is an auto solution. Maybe you can all repeat with me. So he says that I should not get angry with you again because anger affects me by physical, mental, and financial level. So in my own interest, I should be at peace with you. Be blessed. For your part, you should not be angry with me. I've decided to be tolerant with you whenever I am with you. And I'll be very careful not to get angry. So next time you are with this person, you can be unemotional, tolerant, and fully aware of your consciousness and fully aware of your emotions. So what are the things that will happen? Okay, bottling up anger is not a good thing. It's always better to do the auto suggestion, try to identify the root cause of the anger, and try to fix the problem. Okay. Acting versus actual anger. This is one thing I really liked among his writings. So for example, when your kid is doing some mischievous act, I mean, it's in the best interest of you, I mean, to discipline your kid. So in the in this given situation, you can always act like you are angry with that kid, and you can raise in an authoritative tone to discipline the kid. Okay, it's perfectly fine. But within yourself, please be very conscious that I am very calm. All I am doing is I am acting being angry, but not really being angry. So this is something you can practice in situations where you really want to express your displeasure. The conclusion is the state of truth is called absoluteness, and in order for us to pursue the spiritual path, and to become one with the truth, one of the important methods he suggests is completely devoid of emotions and being fully aware of your consciousness. So to lead a very peaceful, virtuous, and happy life, eradicate all emotions and become self-aware. Just 1 minute. Yeah, 1 minute. Okay. So there is one small topic we debated about this being devoid of emotions between me and my wife. Is it possible? Throwing away all emotions and being fully aware and lead a very happy life. So the debate went in this angle. Okay. So we decided that emotions can be classified into positive and negative emotions. So you can treat happy, sad, anger. Anger is something we believe that should be completely removed. Happiness is something we believe that we should cultivate. Sadness, okay, so it's again an important emotion we all carry with us. Say if your loved one passed away, it's perfectly fine for us to feel bad about the situation, maybe for a day or two. The problem is once you prolong it, this emotion, this negative emotion, that's when all the negative effects like depression, sorrow, miseries, sets in. So keeping tab on the negative emotion is something we should always pursue. And the positive emotions, let us all cultivate. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kathy. Vikram, I request you to give the token of appreciation. Thank you. I now request Shri Kuppusami Ayya, Kuppusami Ramasami Ayya to come. We really wanted to hold the best for the last, I guess. We really wanted to thank Dr. Shan. He is the thought force behind a lot of things that is happening all over US and also in other countries. We make fun that all he has to do is think and something, one symposium will happen somewhere, and that is exactly how this has happened. So we really want to thank him, not just for his time and effort, but for his continuous commitment for community service and advancement of science, ancient science and technology. Thank you so much. Please thank Ashwini and your two kids also for this. We'll wrap up. Next is word of thanks by Deepa.
Good evening, everyone. It's my privilege to propose a word of thanks in this occasion. I would like to express the thanks to Dr. P. Silva Shanmugam for giving an excellent coverage to an ancient Tamil medical system. And I would like to express our sincere thanks to Dr. Shanmugamurthy Lakshman to give us a keynote address and other lectures. We wish him all success on Veda University. And we also like to acknowledge our gratitude to Sri Kuppusami Ramasamy, belongs to Vallalar Mission, for explaining the science and enlightenment and immortality and teaching us the yoga of Vallalar. I'm also grateful to Dr. Priyadashini Balamurhan for demonstrating on the acupressure and ways to practice Ayurveda. And we also mentioned deep sense of appreciation to Mr. Sundar Kaliya Perumal for giving us the simplified physical exercise and five elements and nine planet meditation. And to Dr. Abhinav Agarwal for giving a speech on spirituality. We also like to thank the Sky Masters, Kalidas and Sky Master Party. We thank the community centers like Hale Cultural Center and Apex Community Center for their help in conducting this event. We extend our thanks to our media sponsors, Parthasarathi of Vadai Tamil for live webcast, Geek Bazaar and Mr. Afroz Taj Dangal, Namaste RTP, and other organizations like Sai Baba Temple, SV Temple, HSNC, Carolina and Tamil Sangam, HSS, Triangle Area Telugu Association, and grocery stores like Whole Foods, Yardware, Eva Perry Library, Indian grocery stores, and Indian restaurants who helped to spread the word about this program. And I wish all the volunteers who and I thank all the volunteers of Sky North Carolina and of course the ladies who prepared lunch and dinner for the delegates and other volunteers. We thank everyone who attend the program and making this as a successful event. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Hello. We'll just thank Vikram for organizing this, and we just bless Vikram because I know how much of effort he has individually taken. We just bless Vikram and his family for their service, and then we conclude. Okay, so Vikram and his service, Vikram and his family, Vikram and his family and the service. Thank you.